One should never ask, do you make mistakes? Instead, one should ask, do you correct your mistakes? We all make mistakes. The key issue is, do we correct them? Do we correct them? Now, I made a mistake in interpreting a dream that I thought would perhaps mean that the economic collapse is coming. And this morning I was able to get final clarification, and it's actually slightly different than that. I was able to interpret it what I feel is very correctly. But I gave it a real big effort, and in light of what has happened, it's almost like you have hindsight now. I can see it in hindsight. Ah, okay, that's what it is. What I said, I hope I said this in the last video, on Sunday, January 20th, about, I don't know, around 12 noon Eastern time, maybe a little before that, World War III actually started. And it started on the psychic level, on the subtle levels, which all war starts on the subtle levels, actually. And it works, the subtle psychic levels work to impulse the physical level. So the impulses are now hitting the earth from the psychic level. And that will impulse the world into global conflict, World War III. And how I missed that is, you know, I did. I misinterpreted it as a probable economic collapse, which almost happened. Almost, but that wasn't it. What happened was in the dream, just an example of how it's not easy to interpret dreams correctly. And sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. But I don't stop until I get it right. I've been thinking about it for several years, just constantly saying, what does that mean? What's going on? I know it's very important. This massive western wall of this huge mountain, from where I was looking towards the west, so the western wall, I would see it's a western wall to me, suddenly collapsed. This whole wall of like a 10,000 foot high mountain just collapsed. The whole wall, the western wall, collapsed. The wall to the west, western wall. And it collapsed down onto a highway. And I know the number of the highway, it's 111, Highway 111. So I kept interpreting 111 as a date, like was it January, 1st of November, January 1st, you know, 111 or 111. I said, it's a date, it must be a date. I said, ah. And before this collapse, there were several smaller collapses along the western banks. The banks of this western wall, there were several small collapses. I thought that might refer to banks, actual banks. It seemed to be quite, but now I see there's definitely a different interpretation. It has to do with World War III. If you look, just a slight change was all I did. I said, wait a minute. Highway 111 is 111, right? 111. Okay, let's take it, instead of 111, let's take it 111. And Western Wall, let's abbreviate that as WW, Western Wall. Okay, so there, looking at it that way, you say WW, Western Wall, WW, 111, WW, 111. What is that? Well, you know how we write World War I is WW1. World War II is WW11. World War III, WW111, like that. And then the collapse, on the banks, the western banks, lower, smaller skirmishes type of thing, that probably refers to, it could refer to the two desert wars that have already taken place recently, or it could refer to the western bank in the Middle East, that the conflicts there, the small little conflicts that happen, that's going to actually boil over at some point and bring about World War III. It could be either one of those two, but the end result of seeing this terrible collapse of this mountain, the whole mountainside collapse, was incredible fragmentation, just boulders, huge boulders just were going everywhere across the area. And an enormous amount of dust. There was so much dust that nobody could see anything. It was incredible. So what I refer to it as is just an enormous dust up. I call it all that huge dust up, because all the dust was up everywhere, huge dust up. Well, a dust up, of course, is short for a war, a conflict. And this is going to be an incredible dust up, and some we've never seen anything like it. So, it seems as though the prophecies about World War III and terrible conflicts are going to take place. And I was able to be aware that right there, I had said that the inauguration, in time of the inauguration, it's going to kick off what extremely intense conflictual time in the world's history. Very dark, very dark, well, darkest ever. And it happened. It started right then by a massive psychic barrage of thought forms, of violent, impulsive thought forms into the world, trying to impulse the world into global conflict. And the fact is, there's so many unstable people who've been brainwashed to react to the psychic impulses. It's certainly going to be a great dust up. Now, in the dream, I escaped, barely. I had to outrun it. It was like, wow. But I had enough presence of mind, said, whoa, I got to get out of here as fast as possible. So that's where we're at right now, is we're at that time. It's already started. The beginning has already started. We're already several days into World War III, as a matter of fact. And again, I had to adjust my understanding of that dream that I had. It was an incredible, it was a kind of dream you never forget, because you know it's showing you the future, what's going to happen in the future. And I had to continually rework it. I thought about it so many times, trying to think, just what does it mean? I didn't quite think, I feel like I had it quite right. There's something's not quite right. And now I'm seeing WW1111. here it comes. So that's newsworthy, right? That's a big news story. I don't know if anyone else is covering that news story. Probably not. Maybe there's a few here and there that are aware of it. So several days into World War III is our leading news story. Also, as far as the thinking outside the box, let's cover that. That's a nice little segment to have here in these webcasts, thinking outside the box. Imagine if you went to a country that was out in the boondocks or somewhere, and you got into the country and you wanted to travel through that country, and so you went to a hotel and you said, I want to check in, and they said, okay, great, how are you going to pay? And you said, well, here's my credit card, or here's my cash. And they said, oh, sorry, sir or ma'am, we don't take this currency. You know, huh, what? No, we don't take this currency. Wow. So you go to another place, they don't take it. You go to another place, and then someone tells you, hey, no, nobody takes that currency here. And let's say you're a tycoon, you're a very, very wealthy person. Let's say you're very wealthy. And you went to such a place, and you said, look, I've got tons of money. I'm okay. I'm fine here. Like, take my money. I'll triple pay. And he said, no, we don't recognize that money. It's against the law. We don't accept it. Well, how could you travel in such a country? You couldn't buy gas, you couldn't buy food, you couldn't have shelter, you couldn't do anything. So you say, wow, this is a very inhospitable place. I might have to be quiet for a little while. I don't know. This is a very inhospitable place, because they don't take my money, the currency. They refuse to recognize. And it doesn't matter how rich you are. Okay, just a minute. They still don't take your currency. So, big trouble. We can meditate. would you do? Wouldn't that be a problem? Nobody accepts your currency in this country. You're a pauper there. Even though you are super wealthy in your own country, you're a pauper in this country because no one accepts your currency. Big problem. Can't go there. Can't function there. Can't enjoy life there. It's impossible. Now, imagine if instead of trying to redistribute wealth, we redefined wealth. Okay, another thinking outside the box. Forget about this wealth distribution. Let's redefine wealth. Let's make knowledge and information and knowledge equal wealth. Let's measure wealth in terms of knowledge. I realized today, wait a minute, now if we do that, I said that makes me very wealthy. I'm super wealthy, actually. Let's imagine if the universe accepted that knowledge was currency, was value, was wealth. They said, hey, I said, wow, I'm super wealthy. I'm incredibly wealthy, actually. If you use that as a measuring stick, I said, well, I would have to say I'm one of the wealthiest people on the planet right now. And in fact, I have so much money, I could buy myself a place on another planet or two. Most people, I mean, wealthy people here, what do they have? They have homes in several countries, and they travel among those countries, and that's, you know, they have very wealthy people. I said, hey, if knowledge was wealth, I'm so wealthy I could have homes on other planets, actually, and the means to buy a ticket to travel other planets, actually. Might even be able to buy a planet, actually, or several. And yet, in this world, I don't have anything, really. Don't have any wealth. Devoid of wealth. And I keep saying, hey, why don't you accept my knowledge as currency? And nobody will do that here. So how in the world can I function here? It's a crazy thing. In other places, I'm super wealthy. And here, I'm super poor. I have no wealth. I have no assets. I have no capital. I have nothing. Just barely eking out an existence. Trying to pay bills. That's it. So it's a bizarre situation, totally bizarre situation. Why do we not value knowledge as wealth? That is the question. So if you start thinking of yourself, I said, let me think of myself, of my true wealth. I said, wow, I'm incredibly wealthy. In fact, I'm so wealthy that my wealth will never run out because it's compounding so fast that there's no way I could ever run out of wealth if you make knowledge wealth. I'm like forever super, super wealthy. Right at this already. But here, nobody takes that currency. Nobody takes that currency. Which has always bothered me extremely. I said, why do I need money? I got knowledge. Why don't they accept knowledge? Why can't I go into a car dealership and say, I said, look, I'll trade you the car and I'll tell you how to be saved from all suffering. That's a pretty good deal, right? I mean, how valuable is it to be saved from all suffering forever? How valuable is that? I'll be saved from all nightmares forever. Is that as valuable as a car? Our house? Or vacation? Or something like that? So I'd like to barter. I wanted to barter. I said, why don't I just barter? Just so I can survive here. It seems like a very sensible, reasonable thing to do. There's a lot of people who have a lot of wealth, more than they know what to do with here. And I said, well, why don't we barter? I'll barter my knowledge for some of those pieces of paper. And be able to get a car and be able to do things. And nobody wants to do that. They want to hold on to their money. They say we don't want knowledge. We want money. We want paper. We don't want knowledge. So I find it to be very bizarre here, and very hard to stay here. Really, very difficult. Imagine again if you're like some ultra super wealthy person, and you go in a situation into a kingdom where nobody recognizes, you think you have no wealth whatsoever, none. You're a total pauper. And everybody treats you like you're nothing. That's not a very happy situation. Who would want to stay in such a situation? Who would want to travel to a country where they don't accept your currency? That's nuts. You say, leave this place. Why should I stay here? I can just get a ticket and go back home or go somewhere else. So that's called thinking outside the box. Don't redistribute wealth. Redefine it for yourself. And you might say, hey, you know what? Actually, I'm fabulously wealthy. Just imagine if knowledge were wealth. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, and there is some place where knowledge is wealth. How about dwelling there? All right? Wow. In this world, people really think that ignorance is wealth. Naivete, ignorance, not seeing, blocking off awareness, all this stuff. That's what they value. That's what they really value. And that's what earns money here, is being part of the problem instead of part of the solution. That's what's valued here in this world, in the effort to make death real. Being dumb, being naive, being stupid, being a knucklehead, being confused, all these things are highly valued and highly paid in this world. That's what's seen as wealth, and you get a lot of money for it. Sickness, how to make people sick, how to bring about death. Another thing I noticed today is so obvious, it's just amazing. When I say that the purpose of existence is to make death real, and then from death, have life arise from death. First make death real, and then have life, new life arise from death. That's the whole purpose of existence, because the perfect of existence is really a contingency plan in case reality were destroyed. What is real, destroyed. And why are we doing such a stupid thing? Because we want to be prime creator. We want to be greater than God. We want to be God. And that would necessitate a change in reality. And reality is one seamless, unbroken whole that can never be fragmented or changed in any way. If you could change any of it, it would annihilate all of it. So in order to be prime creator, we have to change the whole direction of reality, whole direction of creation. So that would annihilate reality. So we're trying to have a contingency plan of how to survive that annihilation of reality. And how do we do that? By making death real and then surviving it, then having life, new life, come up from that death. And if you look at what nature, you realize that's all that nature is doing. It's constantly dying, and then from that death, new life springing up from that. Just look at nature. The plant grows, it flowers, it seeds. The seeds drop, they separate from the plant dies, and the seed grows again. A lot of things like that. Some have yearly cycles, some have longer cycles. Everything, all the decay here, constant decay, is giving birth to what? New life, constantly. They say, so life comes from death. They say here, there's a cycle of life and death, death and life. Just look at nature and it's easy to see. That's exactly what the purpose of the world is. Yeah, but the problem is that we have is that there's something within us that doesn't accept death as real, which is, of course, the fact that we never left reality. And that part of us knows that death is just a hypothetical. We're just imagining this. And so we say, it's not good enough. It will only be a true contingency plan if it's not hypothetical, but it's real. So death really happens, really happened. And then life really arose from that real death. So we're trying to make death real here, and we can't do it. We keep trying and trying and trying. We say, wow, look at this world. We come in here, and we see everything's dying. And there's all this new life arising, too. And we say, you see, we should be able to learn it here. This world's like a classroom. We've come here to learn that death is real. We're trying to convince ourselves that death is real. And we think if we just believe it enough, it will somehow magically be so. We're trying to have belief be the creative force, and we can somehow magically transform a hypothetical death into real death. So of course, for those who are trying to do that, this world is a perfect classroom for that. You're completely immersed in it constantly. Death, 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 and then life coming from out of death. You can't avoid it in this world. The lessons here, you're super saturated with them. Of course, if you realize that you cannot make death real, why would you come to this world at all? It's a complete waste of time. See, they don't accept the currency of knowledge here. They only accept the currency of delusion here. So if you're deluded, you come here and deluded, everyone says, welcome, 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 welcome to the insane asylum. And if you're knowledgeable and you know you can't make hypotheticals real, they look at you and say, we don't accept your currency here. What are you doing here? You can't live here. You can't be here. So this World War III is to make... attempt to convince us ourselves that death is real. Another big push, as if all this living in this world isn't enough. Because it doesn't work, it's never enough. So here comes some mega world conflict, major dust up that is going to try and use it to convince ourselves that death is real. And then of course after the dust settles, we'll see some plants come up and say, oh, you see, there's total death, and there's death is, and then out of that we're able to bring about new life. Actually, this beginning of World War III is just the beginning of the tribulation period, really. And that continues on and on and on. After the war, there will be other stuff, and then at some point there'll be a global catastrophe, and the world will be actually heated up and melted down like by high energy particles, and the matter and the planet on the surface at least will like be microwaved. It will just heat up and melt, become like pyroclastic, like volcanoes will heat the rocks so hot that there's flow of lava. It's molten rock. Rocks can be melted, alright? I don't know if the heating up actually heats the core of the Earth up so much that the whole planet gets super hot, or if it just melts the surface, I'm not sure, but what I saw, my consciousness was taken out of time, as it were, and I watched this whole process take place of the planet being melted down by intense radiation, and the planet becomes very smooth, like a billiard ball almost, and somehow there's still water here. I don't know if the heating up, if the water did not somehow condense as clouds or something. I'm not exactly sure how, but there was still water on the planet, and it was very inhabitable still, but it was totally changed. It was like a dead place. I actually walked the sands, as it were, after it got melted down. There was no sign of life anywhere. No sign. It was like totally sterilized, the planet. Totally sterilized. And what happened was, I saw people coming out from under the ground. Somehow they had survived it by being underground. I also saw spaceships coming to the planet, and many people spaceship landing, and many people getting out from their spaceships. Humanoid forms, but different than what we're used to, with all sorts of variations. And what they did was they brought all these seeds with them, and plants, and DNA, and all, and they terraformed the planet. I saw what they did. They turned the planet into a very green, lush, terraformed planet. So what? Life coming after death, right? The planet died, and then life was given to the planet, life after death. And so that's the whole mythology of existence at play right there, the entire mythology. What the people don't realize is this is all hypothetical, it's all imaginary. So the death is simply a dream, it's an imaginary scenario. What if this could take place? The terraforming, again, is another hypothetical scenario. What if this could take place? None of it's real. Just a waste of time. Now imagine if you were a teacher, a guru, and you're giving a talk, and people say, "Oh, you're so great, you're so great, you're so blissful, peaceful, loving, happy, and you're so great." And you say, "Why?" Let me role play this. I say, "Well, why? Why do you say that?" And they say, "Well, because you accomplished something that we've been trying to accomplish. And where we failed, you succeeded. So it's unbelievable. Can you please tell us how you succeeded where we've been failed for so long?" And I would say, it's not true. What you're saying is not true at all. I just realized that where you've been failing for so long, I too have failed for so long, and I realize you can't succeed at that. So I didn't succeed where we've all been failing at all. I realized there is no possibility to succeed. And it's like, you don't realize that we're all, let's say there's a wall, it's an impassable wall, and everybody's been trying to get through that wall, and somebody's hitting their head against it, and another person's banging their fist against it, trying to punch a hole. In other words, another one is kicking, and another one is running at it and running into it, boom. Another one is casting spells on the wall. Another one is sitting there chanting at the wall. Another one is worshiping the wall. Another one is carrying out all these rituals, flames and stuff. And another one is trying to seduce the wall. Another one is painting the wall. Another one is composing a song to the wall. And they're all trying to get the wall to crumble and let us go through the wall. And the wall doesn't respond to anything. So along here comes the guru, and they say, "Guru, how did you get through the wall? It's incredible. We've been working so hard, and none of us have ever succeeded. And here you are, you succeed. That's amazing. We're going to worship you forever. This is amazing. Please tell us how your secret. How'd you do it?" And the guru just simply say, "Well, what are you talking about? I didn't succeed where you failed. No way. That's not what happened at all." And the guru will say, "Look, I just realized that it's impossible to get through that wall. But I realize you don't need to. You can just because the whole thing is just imaginary. Everything's imaginary. And this, the wall, your attempts to get through the wall, all this. I just chose a scenario where there was no wall. So I didn't get through the wall. I just saw a world where there is no wall. So I don't need any success. I didn't succeed in anything. I just chose a different scenario, different hypothetical." People say, "What?" That's a totally different answer than they expect. But that's the truth. You don't solve the problems of the world. Nobody can ever solve the problems of the world. It's just you get wise enough and smart enough to realize you don't have to solve the problems of the world. You just choose a different world where there are no problems. And there is such a world where there are no problems. It all depends if you're trying to make death real or not. If you realize you have no need to make death real at all, why do you need to see anything that's dying? Why do you need to see anything that's threatened? Why do you need to see anything that can be harmed in any way? Why do you need to see anything that can be starved? That can be unhappy? That can be self-destructive or anything? Why do you need to see any of that? You don't. You don't need to see a world where any of that is present. You can see a world where everything is completely blissfully happy. And not any danger or threat whatsoever. Nothing dying. Nothing being harmed at all. You can see a world instead, like that. And you say, why bother if it's only imaginary? Because that reminds us of reality. And the only purpose any hypothetical could possibly have is to remind us of reality. That's it. There's no other purpose to it. None. So the teacher hasn't accomplished anything that others had failed at. Not at all. Well, where there's any failure, there's failure for everyone. There's no success. Just chose a scenario where there's no need for any success. Failure is impossible. So why not, instead of hitting your head against the wall, why not just choose a scenario where failure is impossible? There is no wall. There is no barrier at all. Why not do that? Because that's salvation. That's how you do it. And it's a good time to hear all this, because World War III has already started, and the impulses are going to start working on people and working on countries. It's global. The impulse is global. All these thought forms are being spread globally, and like a virus, and impulsing people everywhere in the world. And there's a lot of military equipment in the world, and there's people in charge of all that, and they're being impulsed along with everybody else. And whole countries are being impulsed, leaders of countries, everybody. So where's diplomacy? What's going to happen to diplomacy? What's going to happen to the peace, where you have all these people being impulsed to be confrontational and to start tearing each other's hair out? Where's the peace going to be there? It's not going to be anywhere. Not here, that's for sure. So now I say, well, I feel everyone thinks I'm a pauper here, but in the fact there is a universal currency, there is a dimension, a place, another hypothetical scenario in which I'm ultra super wealthy, actually. So why don't I just use that wealth from there to get a ticket ticket to ride. Why not? I don't have to pay the world for that ticket. I pay the transport that takes me to such a place, and they do accept knowledge as currency. So I'm not really trapped here at all. You know, we have these people, SpaceX stuff, you know, where they have these private rockets now going to take people up into space, but you got to be a billionaire to afford the ticket. And you wonder, how in the world could I ever get off this planet? How could I afford the ticket? What if there was some transport vehicle to take me out of here and take me to a dwelling place where there's not some huge war going on, where there's really don't even need any death going on at all? He said, I don't have the money for that. Even billionaires will say, well, they don't have enough money for that. That must be incredibly expensive. Are you kidding? A ticket to take you to another place, another dwelling place? Must be only the richest of the richest of the rich could possibly afford such a thing. And for me, I'd say, easy. Give me two tickets right now. There's nothing. It's not a drain on my wealth at all. And again, these transports accept knowledge as currency. So it's a funny thing in this world that the whole time I've been here, I haven't spent any focus on money here, attaining money. No matter what I did, I really could not get a hold of any money. And instead, I worked on knowledge. And people now look at me and say, what the heck are you going to do with your future? You don't have any money. You don't have anything here. You got no future here at all. And I say, well, but if knowledge were wealth, and if there were some transport that accepted knowledge as wealth, I can get out of here anytime I want to. I'm not stuck at all. That's one way to look at it. And say, welcome aboard, sir. Welcome aboard. Your money is good with us. Where would you like to go? Like that. VIP, first class, life first class, for sure. So I've purchased a first class ticket and much, much, much more by my work on knowledge, which ends up going to be the currency to have. The currency to have. Because these transports do not accept money as currency. They don't accept paper or coins or credit as currency. They accept knowledge as currency. So all these people in the world who are, you know, going after being billionaires, these ruthless tycoon, is that a word? I don't know if that's a word, because I think I'm transposing something. Magnates, tycoon, that's not a tycoon. Is that it? For some reason, I have trouble with that word. Billionaires, you know the people. Some of them are very avaricious, and they're just after one thing. They want as much money as possible, because maybe they want to buy their way off this world when World War III starts. So they're going to go to the line. You know the old story like St. Peter and the Gates of Heaven, where you get up there, and you get all these high-tech moguls, the richest people in the world, and they're in line, and maybe I'm in line with them, and they get up there, and they go to St. Peter and says, we want to get into heaven. How much is it? And St. Peter will say, well, what do you have? How much do you have? And they say, oh, we got $1 billion. How about that? St. Peter says, no, what? No. They say, well, here's 10 billion. He says, no. They say, 50 billion. We want to get in. St. Peter says, we don't accept cash here. We don't accept. They say, well, credit. We don't accept credit. Huh? How about houses, assets? Except take my company. No, we don't take that. And they say, well, what do you accept? He says, knowledge. St. Peter says, knowledge. He says, well, we got knowledge of, St. Peter says, of what? He says, well, we got knowledge how to make a ton of money. He says, no, you got to have knowledge about salvation. That's how you, useful knowledge. You have to have useful knowledge. If something's not useful, it's not knowledge. If something's not practical, it's not knowledge, at least in the hypothetical context. So all this knowledge about how to win in business and destroy your competitors and gobble up other businesses and dodge your taxes and get super, super wealthy and invest, all this, that has no utility as far as salvation is concerned whatsoever. So it's zero knowledge there. You got nothing. So they're paupers. And St. Peter says, I'm sorry, you can't get a ticket to go into heaven. It's not possible. You don't have any money. You don't have any currency. You don't have any wealth. So I get there, and St. Peter, he will say, all right, yes. And I say, I'd like a ticket to get into heaven. And St. Peter said, okay, and that'll be such. And I say, okay, this is my knowledge, and give him my knowledge. You exchange hypothetical scenarios. He recognized the total non-necessity of trying to make death real, and St. Peter says, come on in. He says, matter of fact, I'll give you a lifetime pass. You don't need to buy a ticket, here's a lifetime pass. And the tech moguls are like, what? How the heck did he get in? He's nobody. He's a peon, a sepoy, a slave, a servant. What are you talking? He's the guy who cleans our toilets. What? How in the world can he get in? That's nuts. That's crazy. And so they're ranting and raving, So St. Peter says, well, you get some wealth, then come on back. But obviously you've been spending your time extravagantly by not creating any wealth for yourself. An incredibly whimsical way. How could you spend a lifetime in such a whimsically extravagant manner and not acquire any wealth at all? That's really very foolish. And they said, but we've spent our lives getting $50 billion. And they said, it's worthless. It's nothing. It's not worth anything. Not to reality, because it doesn't remind you of reality at all. Not at all. They say, well, we buy a lot of cars, a lot of houses, vacations, and that doesn't remind you of reality. It's useless. And if it's useless, how could it be true wealth, you see? So I may not be in such a bad situation as I thought I am. Maybe I can purchase a ticket to ride, which would be actually a very good thing to do at this time. All aboard, because the dust up that's coming is, from what I was shown, is this is the big one. And a lot of prophets have said World War III is going to happen. I think Nostradamus, you name it, it's been out there saying that there will be a final global conflict, and this one will dwarf all the other ones, really. And it's just going to be really totally savage. Trying to make death real, trying to convince ourselves that death is real by, hey, look at all this evidence, look at all this of death, death must be real, trying to convince truth that death is real. And of course, truth knows that death is just a hypothetical, a contingency plan. We're working on a contingency plan, it's symbolic, it's not real. And reality can't be changed, there's no death in reality, so death can never be real. Truth knows that. It's not like you can believe something strong enough that somehow it makes it true. Or it's not like you can name something, give it some name that makes it true. You can't even give it the name of God and make it true. You can't make a lie true by saying it in the name of God. You can't say in the name of God, this lie is true. You can't. It doesn't work. It doesn't do anything. Magic. Reality is not at the mercy of magic. So Here we are. We need a ticket to ride, maybe. Yes, probably. And you think, well, you may think you're a nobody from nowhere, and you have no money, you got no resources, you think, I'm stuck. Not necessarily. You may be actually super wealthy. Think about it. Think outside the box about wealth. Don't redistribute wealth, redefine it. Which is why I've always carried myself in this world as if I were super wealthy. And people look like, what's up with that guy? Well, there's something weird about him. He doesn't look like he has any money. He doesn't have any trappings of money here. What kind of job do you have? So, well, I don't have a job. Or what kind of car are you driving? Oh, some old beat up piece of junk. What kind of clothes are you wearing? What, you're a member of a country club? No. Where are your trappings of wealth? You don't have any. So, and yet you carry yourself like you're super wealthy. So people just think I'm... But some, it's weird. Weirdo, what's the problem? What's the problem? But I do carry myself like I'm super wealthy. I do carry myself like I have all the money in the world, in the universe. Like I can never run out of money. Or wealth, let's put it wealth, never run out of wealth. I'm incredibly wealthy. I always carry myself that way. But in this world, people just look at you like, it's like a beggar walking around like a king. That's like the beggar must be insane. Right? you see a beggar like pretending to be a king. Everybody says, oh, he's putting on airs. What a foolish person to put on all these airs. But I genuinely feel like I am super wealthy, because knowledge is wealth. Knowledge is wealth. That is a fact. And I have enough knowledge to know to exchange hypotheticals. Don't try to solve the problems of one hypothetical. Just choose another one. Because the problem of trying to make death real is completely problematical and always will be. There's no way to fix that hypothetical because you can't make death real. So it's a failure from the very beginning. It's a total failure. How can you make a total failure successful? You can't. But what you can do is you can choose a hypothetical of what if I didn't need to make death real? See? And there's no failure. You don't need to make death real. So how can you fail? It is impossible to fail. So being impossible to fail, that's pretty good wealth, isn't it? Just imagine how the kind of wealth that is, where you can't fail at all. There's no such thing as failure for you. Try to buy that with money, huh? Try to buy that. That's real wealth. That is true wealth there. So in the hypothetical of you don't, there's no necessity to make death real, you're endlessly wealthy, actually. Endlessly wealthy. You can never run out of wealth there, because you can never fail. Everything's perfect. Everything's completely beautiful. That's wealth. Because it's, why? Because it's useful. It's useful. Well, what if someone had like $1 trillion and there's nothing to buy with it? They say, I got all this money, but I can't do anything with it. Then is that wealth? No, it's useless. So real wealth is that which is useful, truly useful. And seeing the blessed world, the hypothetical scenario of no need to make death real, you can't fail at anything. Everything is exquisitely beautiful and it reminds you of reality. So it's super useful. How can anything be more useful than reminding us of reality? That's total usefulness, right? Perfect usefulness, which is hypothetical. That's the best they can be. They can be perfectly useful to remind us of reality. So that's wealth because it's useful. Really useful. That's true currency, right? You say, I got this currency, this world. I've got the world, this blessed world. And I can use that to purchase reality, as it were. It's enough to get me back into reality. In other words, drop all hypotheticals. That's real wealth. That's stupendous wealth, isn't it? Because then you have everything. In reality, you got everything. You're infinitely, endlessly, infinitely wealthy beyond any possibility to ever even describe it, because you never get to the end of it. Your wealth is always increasing. And I could never run out in any way. You never lose any of it. So, choosing the hypothetical of what if we didn't need to make death real, you become fabulously wealthy. You can purchase a ticket to anywhere, even a ticket to reality from there. But in this world, we can know that this is the right thing to do, and that, too, makes us incredibly wealthy, fabulously wealthy. So I feel like I am fabulously wealthy, and yet, from the world standpoint, this is the opposite of that. I'm not destitute yet, but my future in this world would be, certainly looks like it'll be very, very destitute. And yet, I have money to purchase a ticket out of here, you see? And enough to purchase infinite tickets out of here, as it were. I could purchase tickets for everybody out of here, really. And I would certainly do it if anybody would be willing to do that. But maybe people think, oh, I don't want to leave my wealth this world. If I leave it, how can I be wealthy? Okay, again, redefine wealth, and you won't be so scared. And you're going to a place, you go to a place where there's infinite wealth for you because it's infinite utility, infinitely useful. It purchases you a ticket back to reality. So you'll become even more wealthy. Your wealth will be so great you don't even, it's inconceivable how wealthy you will be. This is true what I'm talking about. This is not just, I'm not just kind of throwing that out there for speculation. It is actually fact. It's actually true. So, work on redefining wealth for yourself. What is wealth really? It's not an idle exercise at all. I don't try to give any idle exercises at all. This is super pragmatic, super practical, super useful. redefining what wealth is for yourself, saying, for me, knowledge is wealth, period. And own that currency, own it. And then tell yourself, and then you know, hey, I've got a lot of knowledge. And again, I have enough wealth to buy everyone on the face of this earth a ticket out of here. Everyone. And still, I wouldn't even put a dent in my wealth at all. Not at all. And some of you have enough money to purchase tickets too. See? Because you have a lot of knowledge. If you're listening to these videos, you're already super wealthy. This is really how you accrue wealth. Satsang is how you accrue wealth. Clarification is how you accrue true wealth. So if you're just watching this video, here is enough to get your money, get enough money, wealth to get off this planet. Because you could say, well, I don't have any wealth right now, not so much, but I know that when you take me to the place that I want to go, that my wealth is there, and then I'll pay you there. And they'll say, sure, that's fine, we'll honor that. We understand what you're saying, that you just ran out of money here in this world, and you're being taken back to another place, and there we know that you're good for it, because we know you're super, super wealthy there. So you can do that too. You really can do that. So nobody actually on this planet is destitute and can ill afford to leave the planet. Nobody. The poorest person, the most destitute person on this planet can go to transport and simply say, I want to go to the world which is based on the hypothetical of not needing to make death real. And I will, once I get there, I'll pay you, because I know I've got just a massive amount of wealth there. And they will say, welcome aboard, first class, here you go, come on, welcome. Oh yeah, we know you're good for it. See, they know. There is intelligence in the hypotheticals even. There is intelligence in the hypothetical of no necessity to make death real. There is real intelligence, okay? So they know exactly what's going on. And they say, sure, you're good. We know you're good for it, sir or ma'am. Welcome aboard. The most destitute, the lowest of the low on this planet, the lowest of the low, they would say, welcome aboard, first class, welcome aboard. We're happy to have you here, because they know you're good for it. You've got infinite wealth in the hypothetical of no necessity. What if there's no necessity to make death real? You're infinitely wealthy there, actually. Let's say unlimited wealth, unlimited. Everyone has unlimited wealth there. So, why wouldn't they get on, say, let's go. We don't want to hang around and we're here for World War III. Let's go. So the people that say, oh, no, we don't have the money. They're ignorant. They're, unfortunately, they are have spent their time extravagantly in an extreme extravagance, whimsical extravagance. And so they're unaware that they're actually super wealthy. The only problem people have here is that they're trying to have more wealth than God. You see? And that's not possible. Because God, along with all of creation, has all wealth. There is no such thing as more wealth than all wealth. No, you can't have more wealth than God. Can't have more wealth than any your brother, spirit. Everyone in reality is equally wealthy. It's endless, infinite wealth. You can't have more than endless, infinite wealth. It's not possible. We can't become prime creator. We can't have more than God. It's impossible. But those who feel that they have no wealth, it's because they're trying to find out a way to have more than God, you see. So they're denying the wealth that they have because they say, well, yeah, but that's not more. So they reject it. They say, waste of time. Let's stay here in this world and try to build up wealth, some other type of wealth. We don't need knowledge as wealth, because knowledge, of course, will tell us that we can never have more than everything. So we'd say it's futile, stupid, but we don't even need a contingency plan. And knowledge would tell you that. So they disparage knowledge. They say knowledge is useless to us. Useless. Well, knowledge will tell us that we have infinite wealth. But see, they don't want to know that. They say, no. We want more than infinite wealth. We want more than endless wealth. So knowledge is useless to us, but we're not interested in it. So they say, well, we can't afford to pay the price of this transport because we don't have enough money yet. Because they refuse to use knowledge. Yeah, that's exactly, this is factual situations we're talking about. Again, no speculation here at all. Exactly what the problem is. So I go to everybody, and I say, "Hey, I'll buy you a ticket. You know, if you need a ticket, I'll buy. If you don't think you can afford it, I'll buy you a ticket." And that is me. That's exactly what I am. I'll buy everybody a ticket right this minute. Everybody a ticket on me. It's on my tab. Put it on my tab. I know you're good for it, because when we get there, you'll realize that you have infinite wealth, and then you realize you don't even need to pay me back, because I have infinite wealth too. So it's simple, it's easy, but people don't look in that direction. I haven't done anything difficult or impossible or anything like that. It's nonsense. I just simply looked in the right direction, looked outside the box where everybody's looking, because everybody's denying knowledge. They say, "No, we don't want knowledge. That's because that'll tell us that we can't have more than God. So knowledge is useless to us." So they don't even look in the direction of knowledge at all. They look in the direction of winning and competition and success and acquiring stuff and getting, you know, all this money, get materialism, all these things, you know. And I never looked in that direction. I just said, "Nah, that's a waste of time. That's ridiculous. What's going on here? Why are people doing that? It's crazy. If they don't like it here, come on, get a ticket. Get a ticket. Buy a ticket. Go back to your home. What are you doing here anyway?" So I offer people, no, they don't want it. They say, "I can't afford it. Can't afford it. Can't afford it." Yeah. So they don't have enough money yet. That's a problem, huh? Don't have enough money yet. Infinitely. How can you imagine someone who has infinite wealth saying they don't have enough money yet? I mean, yet. You don't need time to be wealthy. You're already endlessly, infinitely wealthy. Why do you need time to become wealthy? That's like, that's a little strange, huh? What does anyone need time for? Because they want to be have more than God, have more than everything, more wealthy than God. And obviously they don't have that now, so they think, "Well, I'm going to have that in some hypothetical future, and we're working on that." And so when reality is annihilated, we'll have $1 billion and we'll be wealthy. Yeah, what do you buy with $1 billion if there's nothing to buy? Everything's annihilated, there'll be nothing to buy. Come on. $1 billion is worthless, right? It's worth, there's nothing to buy. Well, where's the value in the money? So what are they doing here? Trying to get money. The world's going to be melted down anyway. What are they going to buy with money? It's crazy. That's not a smart currency to pursue. So I've already bought everyone a ticket. They're all at will call. You just go to will call. Sam, there's a ticket waiting for me here. And people say, "Of course, yeah, there's a ticket waiting for you." So I said, "Yeah, Clarity Ross, yeah, he's put a ticket for you on will call." So I officially have bought everyone in the whole world at this moment a ticket out of here, and it's all on will call. You can all go to will call and pick it up. No problem. And anybody else who could see things the way I do would do exactly the same thing, because they know it's not any drag on my finances at all. And besides, if it was, I know you'd all be good for it anyway. But it's not a drag on my finances. So there it is. Go to will call. Pick it up. So how can I be blamed? You know, people would say, "Oh, you're leaving? Oh, how selfish of you. You know, you can afford it. Nobody else can afford it, and that's terrible." No, it's not. I put a ticket on will call for everybody. And just people just said they didn't want it. They didn't want to go. What can you do? You can't force anybody, right? Because if they think it's going to make them destitute, well, here's the thing. They think that a ticket like that is so valuable, and then they have so little money that they'll be indebted forever to try and pay it off. And so they're afraid of that, really. They're afraid of the debt that they get into. And again, what fear of debt do those who have infinite wealth have? Do they have any fear of debt? How could they possibly be afraid of debt? They're paying it, pay it right now. But they think they don't have the money, and there's no way to get it, and they'd have to be enslaved forever to try and pay off such an incredible debt. Because they going to a place where there's no death, they think, "Oh my gosh, that's like priceless. There's no, never put a price on it." So they're afraid on that account, that's a trick. And People are trying to get you indebted and enslaved to them for life. So there's the paranoia that comes in. There's the lack of knowledge that comes in that brings up this paranoia. It makes you think that there's an entrapment, a debt entrapment, which it's not, because you, again, redefine wealth going to the hypothetical realm where there's no necessity to make death real has infinite value because it's a ticket back to reality. So you have that, you're there. You've got the value. So you're infinitely wealthy there. You have true wealth there. So anybody that goes there has infinite wealth there. Anyone. You can be a pauper on this planet. You go there to the death-free realm, and you have infinite wealth. So how could you have debt? How can anyone with infinite wealth have any debt at all? Impossible. You pay it off like that. You pay anything off. Because in order to have a debt, it has to be have some numerical value. Otherwise, it's meaningless, right? It could be $10 trillion, but still there's got to be a value. You can't say that you have infinite debt. How can you say infinite debt? Even then, you have endless infinite wealth, so it cancels out any infinite death. Debt. Infinite debt. And how could you accrue such a debt? What would you need to buy that would accrue such a debt? I mean, reality. You don't need to buy reality. You were born into reality. You are reality. You don't need to buy it. How much does the hypothetical cost? It's worthless. Except, the hypothetical we have now is completely worthless. So it costs nothing. So you can't get a debt from that. And how about the hypothetical that reminds us of reality? That's very valuable too. But it's not as valuable as reality at all. And so you can use the currency of reality, which is endless, to purchase that if you like. Yeah, see? So it doesn't put a dent in your finances at all. Because this hypothetical is only temporarily valuable. Yes, it's very valuable, but only temporarily. Hypothetical of no need to make death real is very valuable because it is a ticket back to reality, but it's temporary. So how could you accrue endless, infinite debt by some temporary hypothetical that you only use for a little while and then you had no more need for it? That is ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. So the whole notion of somehow we could accrue infinite, endless debt is, there's no basis in reality for that whatsoever. No factual basis. Impossible. If you just look at it, you'd see that that's ridiculous. Ridiculous. So you can't possibly be indebted. It's not possible for any of us to be indebted in reality. Impossible. So how could going back to reality end up in a situation of debt? Completely impossible. So how could going to a place that totally reminds you of reality, how could it have any debt for you? Because then it wouldn't remind you of reality at all. So it can't possibly have debt there. It's impossible. But you can look at it from that angle too. The place that reminds you flawlessly of reality can't possibly have any debt for you. So the trip there couldn't possibly cause you any indebtedness either. It's not possible. And add on to that you have, you know, just incredible wealth there. What could you buy out of nothing that would put you into debt? You know, this hypothetical here in this existence is worthless. It's worth nothing. So again, you can't possibly be in debt. So there's that trouble. People think it's entrapment into debt. The entrapment in the debt into debt is this world. That's what this world is all about. Believe me, because I've been through that. I certainly got entrapped into debt. I was going along with the scenario of this world to see just how it all works and what's really going on here, and found out this is how it works. This is what's going on here. This world is entrapment into debt. It lives and breathes entrapment into debt because it doesn't want you to leave. It wants you to think there's something valuable here. It wants you to keep slaving away, trying to make death real. So, let's say you have debt here in this world and you decide to leave this place and go to the death-free hypothetical scenario. And people say, you can't leave, you got to pay your debts. And say, well, you just say, well, look, I'm good for him, I'll pay him later. Throw any amount of interest you want. It's not a problem with me. Compound interest as much as you want. Double it, triple it, quadruple it. The debt, whatever you want to do is okay. I don't care. make it $1 trillion debt. Okay, let's agree. Whatever, let's agree on a figure. You want to make it, let's say you're indebted $50,000. Say, okay, make it 100. Well, they don't like that, make it 1,000,000. They don't like that, make it 1,000,000,000. Don't like that, let's make it 1 trillion. Or whatever you want. Okay, let's just decide. And if you can't decide on any kind of debt, then you're really denying that it's a debt at all. You want enslavement. But you really want, you don't want a debt, because any debt, by definition, is something that can be paid. It has to have a number on it. Otherwise, you're talking about enslavement, right? But the slave said, look, can I buy my freedom? And they say, no, you cannot ever buy your freedom. That's enslavement. It's not debt. But whereas debt is something you go and say, okay, how much do I owe you? Can I get free of this debt? And they have to say yes. Now they say, there is a way. If you pay this off, you are free of the debt. Okay, so make it $1 trillion, let's say. I say, okay, I'm good for it, no problem. But you'll have to come to my bank to collect it, you see. Or I can give you a ticket right now. I'll give you a ticket out of here. That's worth more than $1 trillion. I'll barter for it. Why not? Why should I only accept the currency that this world defines it as paper money, pieces of paper? Now let's barter. And the bank say, no, we don't barter. Well, I do want to barter. Or you can come to my bank in the real world and collect $1 trillion. That's fine with me. So, yeah. You don't have to agree to stay here and agree to their terms, have their definition of wealth and how you pay the debt back. Because really, in this world is worth nothing at all. So there's no real wealth here at all. How can you really pay any debt here at all? Actually, factually, if you want to get a debt paid off, come to the place where there's real wealth. So you get something real. I don't want to give something that's worthless. Let me give you something that's real, that has real value. There's nothing here. Money doesn't have any real value here. What's it buy that reminds us of reality? Nothing. Some statue, some artwork, some nice house. That doesn't remind us of reality. It's worthless. Totally worthless. Nice car, country club, whatever. Worthless. Actually worthless. So as far as skipping out on debt goes, you're not skipping out. You're just going to your bank to get it. So, and then you can barter. I barter too. You say, hey, I've got some land, and it's worth infinite amount of money. You can have the land. There's nothing that says you cannot barter. Because you cannot set unreasonable demands for the payment of debt. And if someone gives you something in kind that has true value to it, then that's fair payment on any debt. How much is a ticket out of here worth? Well, it's worth really infinite. It has infinite worth, actually. So right there, I've already put a will call ticket in everybody's, for everyone on this planet, which means including all the banksters, all the debt collectors, all the people who hold debt. I've given them a will call ticket too. So that's worth infinite amount of money, infinite amount of wealth right there. I've already given it to them. So that's payment in kind for sure. That's payment in kind for all debt. It's payment in kind for everything here. Those who refused such payment, they want slaves. They want slaves to try and make death real for them. We don't have to do that. We don't have to agree with insanity. We don't have to agree to continue to try to do what's impossible. What authority is telling us we have to agree to that? There's no authority telling us we have to agree with that. There's only fearful demands that are insisting on that. It's only the demands of those who want to be greater than God who are insisting upon that. And since it's such a thing as absolute whimsical, extravagant whimsicality, we don't have to be extravagantly whimsical. It's whimsical to the point you have to say they're completely loony. They're in a temporary state of utter insanity. Why do we have to go along with the rules of the insane. We don't have to. No, absolutely not. There's no authority in reality that says that we have to go along with that at all. We're perfectly free to be sane. We absolutely are free to be as we were created to be, which is sane. It's sort of like if someone is engaged with insanity, temporarily engaged with insanity, says that they insist that you pay them 10 trillion nothings, and you can't do anything until you pay that 10 trillion nothings. But how do you pay 10 trillion nothings? You see, it's an insane request. You don't have to stick around in nothing land so until you pay off 10 trillion nothings, because you never can pay it off. You're enslaved. You're wasting your time. You're spending your time idly. You know, God did not create us to be idle like that. Our being to be sitting in a hypothetical nothing place, in a hypothetical nothing future, trying to figure out how to pay hypothetical nothing, 10 trillion nothings, so you can go be free. That's complete whimsical, extravagant, fantasy whimsicalness. That's all. So we are not indebted to whimsicalness, okay? We're not. No such debt. And those who insist that we are need therapy. Okay, they don't need us to humor their fantasies, their insanity. They need therapy. And so our job is to be available to them as therapists, okay? Not as indebted slaves trying to pay off nothing, 10 trillion nothings. We cannot humor them. Like, if you humor the insane, you're not helping them. You're not really helping them. There's a certain degree of humoring, but you cannot take it too far. You have to offer genuine therapy. Otherwise, it'll just build their insanity even worse. So you just say, I'm out of here. They say, you can't do that. Well, guess what? I'm doing it. And your ticket's there, too. And then their sanity says, what do you do with that? I don't know, but hey, I say, I am available anytime for therapy, the therapy that you need. Always available, whenever you need it. It's very simple, very basic, not a problem. And so, what more can you do? That's really, what more can you do? If a brother insists on engaging with insanity, a complete whimsical insanity, extravagant foolishness, well, they're free to do so, but they need therapy at some point, because it's not so easy once you've overlearned this whimsical insanity to an incredible extent. Then you have issues with overlearning. And again, as I said in the previous video, overlearning is the only difficult issue there is. The teaching's easy, but the overlearning part is not easy. Because you believe your very being, the way to prevent you being annihilated is through overlearning. So you can't just, for someone who has believed that for such a long time, you can't just say, oh, snap your fingers and say, just drop this effort to make death real and choose to hypothetical of you don't, there's no necessity to make death real. Just do it right now. You can't, they're not going to do it. You can't, it's not going to work. They're going to say, if I don't have any overlearning, that's just like one instance. If I don't have any overlearning, I'm certainly going to be completely annihilated. So they don't even look at the folly of this at all. That's automatic. The overlearning thing is so automatic with us that we don't even challenge it. Don't even challenge it. So therapy is difficult because it requires overlearning. So these people do have a difficult time. But you're not helping them by refusing to be a therapist. You're not helping them by agreeing with their insanity, by agreeing that you have to pay them trillion nothings. You can just say, look, that was just a temporary humoring thing, but I can't humor you forever. If you want therapy, let's do it. If you don't, then let's wait until you want it. And apparently a lot of aspects of spirit don't want any therapy in this world, so I can't wait here forever for those who refuse, don't want any. What can I say? I mean, I'm entitled to my freedom too. And the therapeutic capability always is there, but I don't want to wait around here during World War III and what's to come. just for the sake of humoring those who don't want any therapy. They don't need to humor them. If they don't want it, they don't want it. If they want to keep trying to make death real, then they're free to do that. I'm not going to try to stop them. So it's really, there's a better way to look at this whole scenario than the way that we're being told we're supposed to look at it. We have the insane telling us that the way we're supposed to look at the scenario. How can that be helpful to us? Not helpful at all. And the insane say, if you don't look at it the way we tell you, we'll never accept therapy. Well, good luck with that. Good luck with that. Because you get tired of nothing. You get tired of futility. Get tired of trying to make death real, and then you try to make both real reality and hypotheticals unreal, and then you experience mental chaos, and at that point you beg for therapy. So all these people, all this bluster in the world of the big wigs in this world say, well, if you leave, we'll never accept any therapy. That's it. For never, 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 never. Well, it's just all bluster. It's total bluster. There's not a single tough guy or tough girl here who, when they experience a total mental chaos, isn't going to absolutely cry out for immediate therapy and the very best therapy possible. Guaranteed. Not one ever. See, this is something I know, so that's why I don't accept the bluster of the world. It's nothing but bluff. Nothing but bluff. That's what they bluff you. They bluff you. If you leave, we'll never, ever, 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 ever accept any therapy from anyone. We'll hold ourselves internally hostage. No, they won't. No, they won't. Because suffering is nasty here. And they inevitably, there'll be attempts to find a way to get free of suffering. And, of course, the ego's got no choice at some point but to say, hey, okay, here's the big secret, entertain mutual exclusives. And at that point, you'll go down in severe depression and experience a moment of total mental chaos. And at that point, you'll ditch the whole thing and say, hey, help, I want therapy, help. And then you'll get it. So nobody is damned. It's impossible to be damned forever. All this is just a bluff. It's an attempt to keep us enslaved here, enslaved to nothing. But how can you really be enslaved to nothing? It's just an aimless waiting is all it is. For nothing. It's just aimless, meaningless waiting. For nothing to happen. Nothing ever does happen, so it's just, it's insanity. So there's no reason that we have to be insane. And again, the whole wealth issue is easily resolvable. The whole indebtedness issue is easily resolvable. And those who play games, delaying games, say, well, we don't know how much you need to be indebted. We're working on it. Well, okay, I'll just say, look, whatever number you come up with at any time, that's fine with me. Fine with me. I don't care. If you can't come up with a number yet, that's okay. I'm not waiting around to find out what the number is. You can come up with any number. So when you get that number, you let me know. I'll be aware. in the hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of making death real, there's no fragmentation, imaginary fragmentation of mind. Mind is perfectly aware of everything. So mind is aware of when they come up with a number, you'll be aware of that and say, okay, whatever number you come up with, let me know. Because whatever number you come up with, I'll pay you instantly. So they spend all this time saying, I want to come up with a bigger number so I'd be more wealthy. But again, how foolish it is for anybody to try to come up with a number on wealth that they want when they could choose infinite wealth. Completely insane, isn't it? So you have these people in the world thinking, we're working on coming up with a bigger number of indebtedness. We're going to demand that. Okay, fine. This is crazy, isn't it? Because whatever number they come up with, it's going to be infinitely less than endless wealth. Incomparably less. In fact, it'll be like nothing. Nothing at all. And it's also all hypothetical. It's no useless, because what are they going to buy with it? The only thing that's useful they can buy is a remembrance of reality. And in this world, there is no remembrance of reality. So it's completely useless to them. It's nutty. That's insanity. That's we're talking about insanity right now. So don't be one of those misers to stay here. So I want to force people to, I want to force those who leave to pay me an incredible amount of money. Again, nothing to use it on, of any value. And any number at all, again, is like nothing compared to what we actually have. So there you're starting to see the true rationale, the true facts about taking off, leaving this place, getting a ticket out of here, as it were, and going to the hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of making death real. And there's such a realm, because I've been there. My consciousness was taken there. I've been there. Absolutely, there's such a place. We just don't think we can afford we can't afford the living there, right? Think, wow, everything must be so expensive there. Well, what is expensive to someone who has infinite wealth? There's no such thing as expense. Actually, there's no expense at all. It's free. Everything's free. But even if we were worried about it, well, how much is a room there, we think? How much is a room there? How much is the house there? Yeah, how much do I got to pay for food or whatever? Or to stay there? Is there a resort fee there? How much to play golf? You know, whatever. No, it's all free. It's all free. There's no charge. How can you set a fee for those who have infinite wealth? What would you use it on? Because reality's free. And you already got this place. You know, it's just all the whole notion of this, all our fears about it's too expensive. We start looking at them. We see it's all ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. Because if someone starts charging us for something, we'll just say, hey, how much for the whole planet or the whole dimension? I'll just buy the whole place and make it all free. And see, because the owner of all that place, which is us really, we make it all free. Because we don't need any income. We're infinitely wealthy. Why do the infinite wealth, endlessly infinitely wealthy need any income? They don't. They don't need any income. They don't need to charge for anything. Right? If you were infinitely wealthy, why would you need to charge for anything? So, see? Again and again and again, the more you look at this, the more the whole thing falls apart as far as all the fears and resistances, etc. You just say, oh, that's ridiculous. And the threat, we're going to compound interest endlessly. We're going to charge you with some huge bill. Well, go ahead. I don't care. Go ahead. Please do. Please do. In fact, give me the bill right now. I'll pay it right now. Here's a ticket out of here. That pays it. The ticket's worth more than all the gold in the world. It's like a mountain of gold. Here's a ticket. It's honored. I already talked to the transport. They say, of course they honor the ticket. Because they know my wealth covers it. I'm good for it. They know that. And of course, those who know all about this, they can leave us tickets too. They're good for it too. If you think, can I get on this transport? And so we say, well, my friend left the ticket for me, right? And they say, oh yeah, of course, I see it right here. No problem. We know that one. They're good for it. Absolutely good for it. Now, think about that. Think about all this stuff, because it's super important right now to think about all this stuff. Don't let your mind be trapped by entertainment. What is that stuff? Is it talking about this? Wasting your time. It's not telling you how to get free, where your true wealth is, how to get free of debt. I mean, all this kind of, it's not telling you that, really. Not at all. So what value does it have? Really no value, right? Especially right now, when we're headed into this very, very bad dust up. What value does that entertainment have for you at all? It's not giving you valuable information at all. So it really is a severe waste of time. It's an incredibly whimsical extravagance to the nth degree, which means if you're doing that, you need to really take stock of, wait, am I being just a really over-the-top extravagant with my time? Is this the right use of time at all, or is it a complete waste of time? It's a complete waste of time. It doesn't tell you how to get a ticket out of here. Doesn't help you realize that you've got a ticket waiting for you, that you can afford it, that you can afford to dwell in the hypothetical scenario dimension of no necessity for death to be real. Doesn't tell you that you can afford that. Doesn't tell you how to pay off all debts. Doesn't pay you, you know, all. Doesn't tell you any of that stuff. Doesn't tell you that it's all free. Doesn't tell you anything. So why is it valuable? Where's the value? There's no value. So why does someone at this time in the world spend their time on something that has no value? It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't stand. It's extravagant. It's whimsical. It's eccentric. Completely eccentric. And if you want to be completely eccentric, there's some people you want to be completely eccentric. Well, knock yourself out. Imagining that the sun aspect of the sonship doesn't have the wealth to pay off some debt. What is that? That's ridiculous. Imagine that somebody needs a debt to be paid to them or something. That's ridiculous. Why does someone who has endless wealth need a debt to be paid to them? That's crazy. So that's totally eccentric. Totally eccentric. And some people here, well, they want to be totally eccentric for a little while. Let them be totally eccentric. That's okay. It doesn't diminish their wealth at all. They think it does. But that's, again, that's part of the eccentricity, is to think that there's some other wealth that's diminished, so they need someone to pay them to pay them a lot. That's their eccentricity. They're waiting for someone to pay them. So why are you waiting to be paid? Why are you waiting? They say, because I'm lacking money. I'm lacking wealth. How can someone that has endless, infinite wealth be lacking wealth? It's impossible. It's a totally eccentric position. It's a completely whimsical fantasy position. Total fantasy. It's not real. Not real. So it's just a dream. It's just a fantasy dream. But they want to dream this. I say, well, okay. But I'm not going to play along with that dream. That dream's no longer interesting to me. So knock yourself out, and you have to find somebody else to role play that with you. I'm not going to do that anymore. Very simple. So, see, you spend some time here, and it's better than spending an hour on the television. It's an hour and a half, right? You're going to watch an hour and a half special by Oprah or someone, and what are you going to get from that? You're going to get something like this? No, really? I don't think so. In fact, I know so. You're not going to. So this is time well spent. It's you're remembering. Well, how could you spend better time than to be reminded that you're infinitely wealthy? You've forgotten this, that you're infinitely wealthy. You've forgotten the whole way the infinitely wealthy are, how they act, how they... Again, they don't need to charge for anything, do they? How do they possibly need to charge for anything? They have infinite wealth. And again, I'm not charging for these videos, am I? Totally free. Totally free to you. That's my attitude, right? I'm not asking anyone for any money. I'm not asking for donations or anything. Because that's my attitude. I says I have endless, infinite wealth. What do I need to charge for? That's crazy. That's crazy. So, and of course, role playing in the game here in this world, practically you have to pay for the internet connection and, you know, that kind of stuff. But as my attitude comes through, now this is all free. It's all free. I'm giving it free to everybody. Just like I'll leave a free ticket to everybody, transport out of here. Absolutely. That is my attitude. That is the way that I am. That's how I see everything. See here. Free. Make it free. Give it to everybody. Why? Why should I charge? I have it when I have everything. What is it that my wealth can't buy? I already have everything. It's crazy to charge, isn't it? All right. Very great. That's about, you know, it's about an hour and a half special here. Time very well spent, reminding you of your true wealth and helping you sort it out. And at least you realize it can be sorted out. I don't expect anyone to have it all clear right now. They say, ah, so it could be. But it's the first time I've even tried to sort it out. So I did pretty well. So I just tried to do it, and obviously I could do it pretty well. I was able to pull up a whole bunch of issues that I've never heard anyone actually in my whole life address these issues, actually. Never. But I just said, why don't we try? When we need to. World War III started. Why don't we just try? It's worth a try. We'll give it the old college try. And we did pretty doggone well, actually. Really, 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 really well. Super well. Which means that means we have focus. You can't do this like this if you don't have focus. And I'm really focused right now. I said, I'm going to focus. I'm going to do it. I'm not going to wait. I'm going to do it right now. And look what happened. Holy cow. We remembered our real wealth. Remember the attitude, how real wealth can really function, true wealth can function, etc., etc., etc. And it's a great leap forward, to say the least. Great leap. Great sidestepping leap. There is an entire realm which is based on the hypothetical of no necessity to make death real. An entire realm. You can call it an entire universe if you want. No death there at all. Everything's free. It's absolutely fabulous, absolutely beautiful, absolutely exquisite, absolutely blissful, absolutely happy. And of course there's transport there. Of course there's transport there. It makes certain that we can all go there, of course. How can it be stopped? It's infinitely wealthy. What? Why is the transport too expensive? Can't afford them? And you think that the hypothetical... Of course, it's only hypothetical transport. So how could there not be? And hypotheticals, everything's hypothetical. It's like in a dream. You're having a dream, and you're in this terrible planet. This ready, war's breaking out, and everyone's dying. And you say, wait a minute. I want to dream another dream of a happy world where everything's good, and you dream another dream. What is there stopping you from dreaming that dream? There's nothing stopping you. So you've instantly transported yourself into another dream. So it's that simple. The decision to choose another hypothetical scenario is the transport. How could transport be denied you? It's impossible. Because it's all just dream transport. Just, if you need transport, just dream up dream transport. There it is. And it transports you to that place. Like in a dream. Let's say you're in a fearful world. You want to go to another world and say, how do I get there? You say, oh, and suddenly the dream is transport shows up. And you get on the transport and whew, you're transported there. And you say, oh, wow, how fortuitous the transport showed up right there. You wanted to go there and you're dreaming and you said, okay, I'll just dream up transport. It's just like that. It's all hypothetical. Existence is totally hypothetical. It's like we're all imagining it, so we'll just imagine transport to take us there. So we'll have imaginary transport will take us from one imaginary realm to another imaginary realm. It's that simple. So there's no way to stop it. No way to stop it. How can you stop dreams? You can dream anything you want to dream. There's no one to stop you except the dreamer. If the dreamer wants to dream that, there is no stopping it. So we just dream up the transport. We say we want it to be. We want it to be transported there, and there's the transport. That simple. Of course, our desire to exchange hypotheticals has already been known ahead of time by those who have already done it, or who are part of God's plan of salvation. So they've already dreamed up transport for us. So we don't have to worry. Then I said, oh, okay, they need dream transport to come to this other dream scenario. They need hypothetical transport to come to this other hypothetical. So they said, okay, let's dream up this hypothetical transport for them. It's already in waiting for us, actually. So, piece of cake. There's plenty of room. Again, it's a hypothetical scenario. How could it ever run out of room? There's no way. It says, we need room? Okay, there's room. We'll dream room up. We'll dream more rooms up. You need more rooms at the hotel? We'll dream more rooms up. Suddenly, there's plenty of rooms. Whatever. So, there's no problem to it whatsoever. There's not really any logistical problems in a dream. The only thing you can't do is you can't make dreams real. But as far as logistical issues, there aren't any in a dream. How could there be? You want water? You can dream up in a lake. No logistical problems at all in a dream. There's no logistical problems in reality either. Because whatever you want, whatever idea you want to choose, it's instantaneously yours. The only problem we have is that we can't make hypotheticals real, but we don't need to, so it's not a problem. So we just need to realize the situation we're in, hypothetical, and know that we only need the hypothetical that remind us of reality, so we can set hypotheticals down. That's it. Because we want to get back to reality. That's our true home. We'll never be happy in hypotheticals. Even a beautiful hypothetical, we will not be eternally happy in that. Because it reminds us of reality. You say, reality is even better. Even better. So there again, we've solved the problem of wealth, debt, and transport, and place we're being transported to, the price of staying there is free. All those issues have already been solved. Everything. Of course, people will think up other problems. But the basic, we've covered the basics. For the most part, I think we've covered the basics. And so we can certainly now at this point take a deeper look and say, hey, you know, maybe we should start being aware of the hypothetical transport. That'd be a good idea. Get used to that hypothetical transport. Maybe in dreams, maybe we'll even hypothetically go to this other hypothetical realm and see what it's like. Check it out. When in doubt, check it out. And don't fall for the thing that, well, some beautiful person from the hypothetical realm will come into this world and live here, and you can spend your time hanging out with them, because the world's going to be engulfed in a global conflict, well, terrible, and catastrophe. That's all going to play out here. That's the purpose of this hypothetical. You're not going to be happy hanging out even with a great guru. You're not, not really. Because you say, hey, I could be in a much better place. I can be in a place where there's no war, no conflict whatsoever. There's no death, no attempt to make death real at all. There's no death at all. Absolutely. Because again, the only utility of hypotheticals is to remind you of reality. Hanging out in this world with a guru, even a great guru, it doesn't really remind you of reality that much. Maybe a little bit. A little bit. A little bit. That's all. You need something way, way better than that. You need to hang out in the hypothetical, the death-free realm, the death-free hypothetical. The hypothetical is that, what if there was no necessity to try and make death real? You need to hang out there. In order to remember reality, you need to hang out there. So, don't fall for this nonsense that there's supposed to be some great guru who's supposed to return to this world, and you don't have to go to this hypothetical realm of non-necessity of making death real. That is good enough to stay in this world, hang out. That's nonsense. It is not good enough at all. Really. Even if, like, Jesus were here, or Sri Nanamaya Ma, and they said, you can get a choice either to hang out with them here in this world or go to the hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of making death real, I'd say, boom, I'm going to the other hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of making death real. I'm going there. I'm not staying in this world even if Jesus were here. You know, no way. Because that doesn't remind me of reality enough. Not even close. What it reminds me of is the necessity to go to the hypothetical scenario of the non-necessity of making death real. That's what it reminds me of. So that's why I go there. And of course they tell you that's what you're supposed to do. Of course they're not going to say, don't hang around here in this world because I'm here. That's crazy. Get on the hypothetical transport and go to the hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of trying to make death real. Go there. Come on. Go. Exactly. That's what they tell you. So that really clips the wings of one of the ego's main subterfuges, is the idea there's going to be some super guru coming to this world, and you can't possibly leave this world because you'd miss out on that. What utter nonsense. But first of all, any great guru like that could bilocate, could trilocate, could do any location they want to simultaneously, because it's all hypothetical anyway. So they could be two places at once. They could both be in this world and in the hypothetical scenario of non-necessity of making death real. So you wouldn't be missing them at all. You wouldn't be missing them at all. So the ego's whole lie, deception of saying you better not leave because something great's going to happen here. Pfft, house of cards, utter nonsense. But it certainly tries that one. It tried that one on me, and it worked for a while. It actually worked for a while. I said, wow. What if Sri Nanamaya Ma came back in the world? I wouldn't want to leave. Now I see that's utter nonsense. Utter nonsense. I'd say, thanks for coming, but bye-bye. Good luck with helping everybody. I know you're going to help everyone, but I'm out of here. I'm really out of here. What am I supposed to do? Hang around? So she goes to the Kumbh Mela, the Maha Kumbh Mela, which is taking place in Allahabad right now. Hang out there. Why would I want to hang out there? I just saw a video on the 2010 Hardwar Kumbh Mela. I don't know if that was a Maha Kumbh Mela. It might have been. Was it 2010? Or was it 2-1, whatever. You kidding? I wouldn't even want to hang out there for a minute. Not even a second. They have all these gurus were talking. It's rubbish what they were saying. Absolute rubbish. There's no one there saying anything that's like likes being said here. It's ridiculous. I saw all these high big wig gurus. Even the Dalai Lama was there, you know. It's a great movie. Great. Maybe I'll put a link to it down in the video description here. Great hour and 40 minutes something movie. Great movie. Showing the Kumbh Mela like a way that nobody's ever shown. It is really fabulous. And you see what it's really about. And I came away saying, are you kidding me? I wouldn't spend 1 second there. Not even 1 second. Totally worthless waste of time. It's not focused on what we need. It's not focused on what we need to know at all. So, you know, what's the big deal? What, I'm going to leave this world? And they say, oh, you can't leave this world. You're gonna miss the next Maha Kumbh Mela, the Purna Kumbh Mela. There are going to be 200 million people at that one. Wow, you're really going to miss that. I say, what am I going to miss? What exactly am I going to miss? So, it's actually very valuable for you to watch these videos of all the stuff that people say you're going to miss. You're going to miss this. You're going to miss this, even if you're here. Even videos of Sri Anandamayi Ma, which I can post those. Maybe that'd be helpful. They say, you're going to miss that. Well, so what? So what, really? Because going to this other realm is infinitely better, reminds you of reality, infinitely better than even Sri Anandamayi Ma in this world. That's a fact. Because I've actually seen both. I've seen all the pictures, basically in the world of Sri Anandamayi Ma, and all the videos that are available in the world. And I know those who have seen her in person, actually. And I've also seen the real world, this other hypothetical world, the world where of hypothetical, the non-necessity of trying to make death real. I've seen that, and I can tell you that world is infinitely more useful than seeing Sri Anandamayi Ma in this world. Infinitely more useful. That's a fact. That is a fact, and I'm someone who can tell you that. There's not many people that can tell you this truth, but I can tell you that. So maybe I will make some videos. It might be very helpful for you, but I'll make them for the purpose for you seeing what is your choice, what is the smart choice to make, and of course it's to leave. I don't care if there was a whole army of great gurus like Sri Anandamayi Ma came in this world, going to the hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of making death real is infinitely more useful, incomparably more useful. Your wealth there is incomparably more. I don't care if there's a whole army or a whole world full of super gurus in this world. Still, the hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of making death real is infinitely more useful. So the ego has no currency to hold you back, none whatsoever. But it's helpful if you actually see it for yourself, because watching that movie on the Kumbh Mela, the Maha Kumbh Mela, and seeing all these gurus, I'd never seen that before in the Kumbh Mela. And they took you and interviewed these gurus, and you see all the bigwigs that show up there. And I couldn't believe it. I said, are you kidding me? This is the way they're saying use your time this way? Totally eccentric, extravagant, whimsical way to use your time. Nonsense. Totally extravagant. What a waste of time. But seeing that it's a waste of time is not a waste of time, because it helps you make your decision to abide in the hypothetical of the non-necessity of making death real. I said, now it's easy for me to say, oh my gosh. I don't care. You have infinite number of Kumbh Melas with all these gurus. It's a waste, total waste of time. I'm not going to hang around for you in one more. No way. No way. You're kidding. So there is some great help in making these types of videos and watching them. For me, it's great help. I can make them on Sri Anandamayi Ma. I really can. And no disrespect to her, because she'd be the first one saying, yeah, please do that, because that's like a super helpful thing to do. She doesn't want you hanging around here waiting for her to come back. Are you kidding? Because she had words out of her own mouth, says, look, every single one of you eventually has to divide in the death-free realm, which she knows is the hypothetical realm of the non-necessity of trying to make death real. She goes, every one of you must eventually abide in that realm. And that's what she says, that's what I'm here for, to help you realize that's what you must do. That is, you have no choice but to do that. So she'd be absolutely overjoyed if somebody here were to use her videos and show her in such a light of saying, hey, don't hang around here waiting for her. Abide in the death-free realm. That would be right use of her coming here, her videos and her pictures. Right use of them. So maybe I'll do that for you. And I'll explain why I'm doing that. You will know why. And there are other videos I can recommend to you which are very helpful. And that Kumbh Mela one is definitely super helpful use of your time. Super helpful, because you can evaluate. No disrespect to anybody, but we have every right to evaluate how to use our time. Every right. There's no insult to anybody. How could the Son of God be insulted by another aspect of the Son? It's impossible. Come on. Impossible. No insult. We have every right to evaluate our use of time. And we should support that to everybody. Everyone. If someone says, hey, I want to listen to Clary Ross's video, it's a waste of time. Fine. If somebody thinks that it's a waste of time, it's not an insult to me. As long as they're looking at, like, hey, what is best use of time? Oh, excuse me, I'm doing some taping right now. Okay? You have to come. All right. So, that is an absolute fact. And more requests for donations or something. They're out and around right now. Again, is that a good use of time? So, it's very important that we make the right use of time right now. And watching these videos, I will go to work on some of that stuff possibly. We'll see if that's the best use of my time. Okay? So, the neighborhood is crawling with people who want money to do these fabulous things, and we are spending time here realizing that we have a ticket, a will call, to really go to the hypothetical scenario of the complete non-necessity to try and make death real, which is our responsibility. We have to do that at some point. We have to know it, because we have to be reminded of reality. We have to be reminded of reality. There's no choice whatsoever. So we eventually have to do that. Now's a great time, because staying in this place is going to be absolute hell. I've seen what's going to happen. Absolute hell. All right, where are we at? 140. That's about the same length as the Kumbh Mela video. And again, I'll link down there below, and I'm recommending watching that video. It gives you an inside look, an really inside look to the whole situation. What really takes place. And right now, of course, the largest gathering in the history of the planet, 100 million people in Allahabad. And everybody thinks that's the place to be. Wow, that's some transformation, blah, 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 blah. Oh, come on. Find out what's really going on there. And you say, now I got a better way to use my time. Okay, very great. That's it. I'm going into my cave now and see how else I can help. Really, again, I've already purchased a ticket for all of you, so I will call. All right, great, that's it.